2, what's your status? Unit 2, do you copy?
Black Tusk must have set charges on the bridge. They weren't taking chances. We've got to press on. You're headed for a small dam just north of your position.
This is JTF Unit 1 Leader. We're starting off.
Intercepting Black Tusk communications.
Engaging a large group of hostiles in the northwestern perimeter.
They're going for the helipad. Get in front of them and fuck up their day. Ghostlight, we need immediate extraction.
Ghostlight, on move. ETM, over mics.
Copy that, Unit 1 Leader. Godspeed.
Incapacitated.
Unit 1 Leader, have you reached the objective?
We have it in sight. We're encountering heavy resistance.
Are you going to be able to lock down that helipad?
We're working on it!
Galveston. You've got an SHG element approaching your position.
Copy that. We gotta move, Chief.
Are you talking to me?
Who else would I be talking to? Gather your shit and let's go. Galveston, Chicken Hawk is on the move. Finally.
Chicken Hawk? Fuck yourself. Where are we going?
Into the tunnel, Chief.
They must be cutting through the bunker. There's an entrance just ahead. You should still be able to catch them.
Why is that door still open?
It's closing now, sir. Door sealed.
Shit. No way you're getting through there. You're gonna have to take the long way around. The bridge southeast around the ridge.
Thank you.
JTF Unit 1 leader. We're pinned down, taking heavy losses. Is the helipad locked down?
Negative! We can't break through!
Shit. We can't let Ellis get away.
Electronic device detected.
You must be Barton Schaefer. I've heard great things.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't listen to idle talk. I'm pretty lacking in redeeming qualities.
Right.
Aren't we all? So, let's talk about this cure-all snake oil I'm supposed to ship out of here. Yeah.
Ghostlight, where are you, buddy?
Odd approach. Couple of mics out.
Roger, Dodger. Gonna have to stand by for a few. We're taking our sweet time.
Sounds like you can still overtake Ellis. Unit 1 leader, do you have eyes on Ellis? Unit 1 leader, do you copy? Shit! gonna lose them.
No survival.
Roger that. Respond.
Getting Ellis was always a long shot. Black Tusk specializes in dealing with situations like this. But the site is under our control, and we didn't give the enemy time to clean up after themselves. There's gonna be a lot of useful intel there. We can take our time picking through it.
Thank you.
agent. Pilot Torres is cleared for transport to Kenley College.
Entering safe area. Is no longer in your group. agent requesting backup.
So fired up for the Cleveland Browns this season. I can't wait. And Hard Knocks is doing the Raiders. Should be fun. Super fun.
Is this the last season in Oakland or the Vegas thing?
No, they're the last season in Oakland. Last season in Oakland, and then they go to Vegas. But that John Gruden trade, he got so much shit for it. Unless it's a deep cut in football, but whatever, we'll move on after this. That John Gruden trade that they did for Khalil Mack, and he got all those first-round draft picks, and he shipped out all his guys. And now he's bringing in all these other guys, and he got all the picks. I'm telling you, man, the Raiders, as much shit as Gruden got for all that, people are saying it's one of the best trades of all time. Like, it's a crazy. People are like, how can you trade Khalil Mack? And John Gruden's like, okay. You don't think that guy knows what the fuck he's doing?
He's a mad scientist.
A mad scientist. You don't think he knows exactly what he's doing? I would be willing to bet a lot of money if anyone wants to take this bet. I bet you the Raiders are AFC West champions in the next 4 years. From Gruden's moves. He's a fucking monster, man. Even I was like, damn, you trade Khalil Mack, the best defense player in the league. You got your goddamn mind. But Ian, guy doesn't buy into my system. Once he get out of here, we're gonna get a shitload for him. It's a deep cut of football for the fans out there, but whatever. Shout out to Javonte Davis, get it done. Gotta fight a big thing. Gotta fight a big thing. Have to. There's UFC 240 going on. So what I did is I bought, right, ESPN Plus, paid $70 for it. Wish I did it. Gotta be honest. I thought, listen, besides the main event, the co-main event was cool, which we'll get into. It's cool for a different reason, but this past weekend's pay-per-view and next weekend's pay-per-view are so bad, man. They're so bad. Those should be fight nights. If this was a fight night, the numbers would be low. If this coming week's was a fight night, those numbers would be shit. Let alone pay-per-view. You're charging people $69.99, I think that's how much it is, I don't know. You're charging people $69.99 for a card of this magnitude? Dude, I was bored and I was staring at the wall during most of these fights, man. This weekend's fights, I couldn't tell you who's on them. I don't know. I know the main event. Other than that, I don't know who the fuck is on it. I know four people on the main card of this UFC.
I totally forgot about Jim Miller, Clay Guida. Like, they haven't been promoting that at all.
Mickey Gall's on there, but he's not on the main card. Scott Holtzman, I know him. All right. Dude, these cards are... That's what you get now, man. But then that August 17th in Anaheim, DC stacked. But why make these pay-per-views? Does ESPN need to make up the money that bad on the nut they bust on paying for the UFC rights? Why are these not fight nights? Out of, like, the people I associate with, I don't know anyone who bought it. I was the only one who bought it. And now illegal streaming's gone, too? This weekend, I'm in Nashville. I think my Saturday show's sold out. That's how shitty this card is. You know? So it's like, I mean, who's watching it? I don't know, man. But these fights were so bad. It was just a boring night of fighting. You had majority all decisions. The biggest kind of like highlight of the night, that Neil over Nico Price was an amazing win. The Chris Cyborg, Felicia Spencer. Isn't it weird? Don't you think it's weird how everyone roots against Cyborg? Because people were over my house and I found everyone rooting for Felicia Spencer. Me too. But I know Cyborg personally. I know how good of a person she is. And I'm like, these people don't know Cyborg. They don't know Felicia Spencer. But they root for Felicia because she looks the part opposed to Cyborg. That has to be the only reason why you wouldn't root for Cyborg. Because she looks like she's physically enhanced, right?
Good baby Goliath, I think.
Yeah, I feel bad for her. I kind of feel bad. But people are like, well, she did take PDs. I know, I get that. I definitely get that. Changed her physicality and her structure's different. And she hits like a fucking Mack truck. But I don't know one person when she fights where you root for. I do. I know her person, right? Great, nice. One of the nicest people in the sport. Nice. Like, you've seen her, met her chin.
Yes,
she's the nicest. And she says how she's getting bullied, like her daughter's getting bullied in school because of her. And, you know, a lot of this hate for her, despite her physical looks, her physical traits, would be because the narrative the UFC paints every time of her. Like Dana White goes, she doesn't want to fight Amanda Nunes, so then everyone jumps on that. Or, you know, he said, she looks like Vanderlei Silva with braids. So Dana gives everybody the okay to shit on Cyborg. She's never been treated right her entire career. When she fought, when she got poker, he highlighted her, treated her right. But outside that, man, it's always been kind of a sad story. I find her whole, especially her UFC career. You gotta remember, when she came to the UFC, they went, yeah, come on over, but you gotta make 140. She's like, what the fuck, man? She's just never, she never had a good relationship. They've never kind of rallied around her. It's heartbreaking. But at the same time, I can see why they don't. Like, I try to put myself in the UFC's shoes. Like, I can kind of see how they don't because, I don't want to say this without hurting her feelings. Because if you're trying to grow the sport of female fighting and you show someone like Cyborg, I think that would actually deter girls from fighting. Is that fair to say? Is that fucked up?
Why?
If you show me Ronda or you show me Paige VanZant or you show me, and this isn't a sexist thing, this is a very black and white thing. If you show me Paige, you show me Ronda, you show me Misha Tate, you show me who's the ultimate fucking nine piece. Yes, Rich Osmond, too. I mean, she could be on the front cover of Playboy. She could be on the front cover of UFC Magazine. She could be in Maxim. She could be at the Playboy Mansion. And then she can punch you in the face. So she's the hottest fighter of all time, right? She looks ridiculous. If you show girls that, and girls go, those pretty girls are doing it? But if you show them Cyborg, 99.9% of the female population does not look like Cyborg. Girls can go, I definitely can't do that, man. That's what it takes to be a cage fighter. I can't do that. So if you're the UFC, you're not going to drive that narrative of, hey, watch Cyborg fight. That's not best in the future. Is that super fucked up to say?
I know what you're saying.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Because
like,
here, yeah.
Like, because it's the same thing with Roy Nelson. They really didn't push Roy.
Exactly.
So because they didn't want to go, hey, look at Roy. He looks out of shape, even though he's a world-class fighter, even though he has a world-class history, record, won the ultimate fighter. There's so many knockout artists. They didn't go all in on Roy because they didn't want to let everyone know, hey, you can look like you just came off the bar stool and knock world-class athletes out. So they didn't really push Roy either.
Yeah.
And they're not pushing Cyborg either. But they push a guy like, let's say, Shortcut. They push a guy, you know, you think of all the guys in your head, Darren Till, Conor McGregor. There's, it moves the needle for them in that direction to invest in the legacy of the sport. Does that make sense? Is this super fucked up what I'm saying right now?
Do you remember my favorite fighter was Chuck Liddell, right?
Yeah.
So back in the day, there was all these dudes that are steroided out, they look huge, and Chuck would just knock everyone out. And I was like, dude, he looks like a dude that, obviously he had like a shame size and stuff and a mohawk.
But he didn't look like Kevin Randle.
Yeah, exactly. When he fought Kevin Randle,
yes,
he knocked him down. Yeah, I was like, that's why I was such a huge fan. Because you didn't expect it.
Fedor too.
Fedor too.
Ultimate dad bod. He looked like Hopper before I did. But he was knocking the best of the best out, where you'd be like, what the fuck?
Well, guys, it's different because they did push Chuck, right?
They did, but Chuck was in like, yeah, but with girls too, it's like, you know, they Ronda,
they pushed her.
With a complete package, badass, moved the sport. I feel like with Cyborg, to her detriment, and I don't think it's fair, but we'll take out my relationship with Cyborg. Say I do not know her, and I'm from a different sport or different business, and they put me into the UFC marketing chair. And I go, all right, okay, here we go. And at the time, let's say Cyborg were champ, and I'm looking at all the lay of the land, I'd go, what's going on here? And they give me the background, like, that's tough, man. And I look at Paige Van Zandt, like, what's going on here? And what's my number one? I gotta sell tickets, and I gotta evolve. I need to sign up more memberships for female fighters. All right, we're gonna push these people.
Yeah.
So I get it from that standpoint. I'm not saying it's fair. I'm not saying it's right. I'm saying I understand from a business standpoint what the UFC is doing.
It's easier.
But I don't approve of the way Dana's gone about shaming Cyborg.
Yeah, that's totally not cool.
No, it's not cool. Throwing shade at her nonstop. And then when I find out her kid's being bullied at school, it just breaks your heart. And then, I mean, there's no way to do this. This is with any person.
Where are you?
We just got to the aquarium. If you could just beat Cyborg, man, you
okay,
would not throw those comments
right
at her.
To you.
My mind.
Give him a nice, warm
it's
welcome.
It's incredible when you actually meet her. Yeah, she's super nice.
Super
nice person. So nice.
You know, even today, you know, they're going back and forth, and you see, like, footage of Dana White behind the scenes with Cyborg, and she's like, I told you, I texted you after in the Nunes fight, I want a rematch, and he was just kind of like, I know, no, and he said something about business or whatever, that's
yeah.
what she said,
yeah.
But even this morning, you know, she's kind of thinking of maybe not re-signing,
yeah.
He started saying again something like,
scared.
Yeah, she wants to fight easier competition outside UFC.
It's because it's a negotiating power.
Of course,
yeah.
Yeah,
right? Because now, if she goes to Bellator, she goes to Ryzen, Dana, you know, she's just afraid,
yeah.
And Cyborg's like, no, I'm not afraid. I want to be paid what I'm worth, brother. I mean, it's not that I'm afraid. I don't know if she's gonna say brother. I don't know why I turned into a Hulk Hogan. She used to be like, no, one's afraid. I've fought everyone. But you gotta pay me what I'm worth, so I'm gonna stay here. Because A, you diminish what I stand for in the media. You don't move the needle for my, you're not helping my legacy, you're hurting it. So if I stay here and fight Amanda Nunes, which for Cyborg to get over the hump, to be considered the Grand Fall Nine, which she would before she fought Amanda Nunes, she lost, right? So Amanda definitely flies past her. She'd have to beat her twice. She got starched the first time. Let's say they fight a second time. She beats Amanda. Well, that doesn't mean she surpasses Amanda. Look at Amanda's resume. She's still number one of all time. She'd have to beat her twice. So you'd have to come up with a contract that fight if I beat her, the rematch clause, you know?
Yeah.
And there's not a lot of competition for it anywhere. Let alone the UFC, Bellator. So that's a problem she's having, Jenna. It's a tough situation, what I'm getting. It's not that black and white where
Rainer,
just sign her, man, have her
status?
Fight, because I don't know if it's the best move for Cyborg,
Rainer,
I don't know if it's the best
in.
Move for the UFC. The UFC can take it or leave
what?
It. They don't really care. They're not going to throw huge money her way. Amanda Nunes doesn't need it. She doesn't have a lot of fighting left. I don't think she cares. So Cyborg's not in a great spot. She's also older. She's a tad older. But also, like, I'm the same with this. With that Felicia fight, the Felicia Spencer fight, You find yourself going, goddamn, Felicia Spencer's good. Man, how tough is she? But you forget that Cyclops beat the shit out of this girl. I mean, Felicia Spencer landed the one elbow that cut her up. That's it, man. Couldn't take her, didn't have a prayer taking her down. Didn't went around. Cyborg pieced that girl up, landed some huge shots, but the whole time, the whole narrative, including on the commentary, was, God, this Felicia Spencer, man, it's tough. Yeah, no doubt, she's tough. That's not the point of the sport. The point of the sport is to outstrike the other one and inflict your will and land punches. Cyborg did all of that. The narrative from her fight was, how great is Felicia, even though Cyborg dominated all three rounds. The fight was in close. But what was fun to watch and say was, God, how good is Felicia, man? A lot tougher than we thought. Dana went to her dressing room after the fight, went, you got a big future, man. You're gonna be a star. But what about the girl that beat the fuck out of her, man? What about her? Oh, yeah, that was cool. Let's talk about the girl who got her ass whooped, though. And I like Felicia. I'm a fan of Felicia. She beat Megan Anderson. She was Invicta champ. She has some skills. But compared to Chris Cyborg, to put it in Brian Callen terms, she's an infant. As far as skills, striking, grappling, jiu-jitsu, and then the whole narrative the entire time was how tired Cyborg was. I thought Felicia was more tired than Cyborg. It's this narrative that the UFC comes up with every fight for Cyborg. She's tired, man. She looked tired against Holly Holm. She was tired of beating that ass. Tired of punching her in the fucking face. Maybe. Tired of defending every takedown. Maybe. Tired of not getting hit. She didn't get hit. She got hit with an elbow early, you know, and split her open. Okay. The whole narrative, even though she posted a flawless victory, was how good is Felicia Spencer? Again, I love Felicia. Hell of a
electronic
performance.
Device detected.
She got her, and that fight was even close. You could have gave it, you could have gave all 10 8 rounds. The only thing she landed was an elbow. But we all go, that Felicia Spencer, man, that shit was crazy. I heard some dummies go, best female fight of all time.
Anybody in range of the Savannah exhibit?
What the fuck were you watching? I watched them. I've seen all the bad fights on Bully Beat.
Fall back to engineering and make sure no one gets through.
I feel bad for that. But at the same time, I get it. If that's fair to say. And then the main event, now these fights, like, lived up to their... Again, the Chris Cyborg one was fun because Felicia is just tough as fucking nails, right? That Amon Tusanakin, what the fuck his name is, against our boy Oliver. Lucier, gonna be getting easier names for fuck's sake. But that Amon, supposed to be this protege at 22, I didn't see him that night, you know? Grappling, boring fight, got kicked in the face, Oliver lands a huge knee, but he just grappled a ton, but everyone was just sucking the skin off.
You should be able to fry that repeater by overloading the power.
He looked amazing. Nico Price, he's probably the highlight of the entire card. There's the MVP, it'd be him. I know everyone's giving to Felicia Spencer. You can, for not getting knocked out, but as far as performance-wise, it'd be to Neil. You get the job done, pass the test, Nico Price is tough as they come, amazing finisher, amazing striker, knocked him out. How about when fucking your girl Felicia pulled guard, half guard, and got her ass beat the fuck up.
That was fucking weird.
Oh my god, she pulled that guard and went, oh, that's cool. She must have a really good ground game. Cyborg beat the fuck out of her on the ground. Get back up! Holy fuck, get back up!
She pulled guard like her head to the fence, though. She was just pulled guard.
Pulled half guard.
In like the worst
moment. Cyborg said, cool story. Ground and pound's my best thing. 10-8. Pulled guard and got the brakes beat off of her. And then Dana White goes to her locker. And not Cyborg. You gotta feel bad for Cyborg.
Yeah, they never really profiled her, like, outside the cage. Like, they kind of painted the new villain, like, just knocking him out. They never, like, you see all these other, like, countdown and, like, pieces about people outside the cage. They never really profile, like, her that way. Like, you know, when she went to Africa with Justin Rett, right?
Went to Africa, opened a bunch of wells,
yeah.
Has a daughter who's getting bullied. Her story's fantastic.
We don't hear about that.
Here's the thing, the UFC goes, she didn't have that long left with the way she looks. It's actually gonna hurt the growth of female fighting and health, I think. I'm assuming that's the motive behind it. And she's difficult to deal with. Now, difficult to deal with, according to UFC. You talk to Cyborg, she's like, dude, I just want to be treated fairly. I'm sure if you talk to Nick Diaz, they will, we just want to be treated fairly. That's why we're not fighting. We're trying to pull our chain. I'm always, 99.9% of the time, going to side with the fighters on this. Been in their shoes. Understand what Nick and Nate do, why they don't fight as much. Understand why Cyborgs have issues.
That'll cut the range of their comms significantly.
It's very rarely
keep
ever
going.
The fighters' issues.
You should be coming up with
what's
right
when they think
right.
The
control room
it's
usually
not some outlandish plane, you know? Then the main event, Max Holloway, Frankie Edgar. I thought this would be a tougher fight for Max Holloway after the Dustin Poirier fight at 55 didn't go that well for him. I thought it was maybe a little too soon, and the matchup-wise, Frankie Edgar's a monster. His movement, his takedowns, and Max Holloway just shows you why he's the greatest featherweight out there. He looked amazing. Maybe get Frankie around. I don't care if you want to give him the first or the fourth. I don't care. You can give it to him, I guess. But other than that, he got outshined. Max Holloway just looked phenomenal. Phenomenal. 45 is his home. I don't know who's going to fucking beat that kid. The Australian rugby player used to be 200 pounds, maybe. But even then, Max Holloway's just such a fucking savant when it comes to featherweight. He's so goddamn
jab.
Yeah, his jab, his takedown defense, his footwork, even though he doesn't look like he's doing much, even though he's wide stance, flat-footed, you're not touching him. He's so goddamn good.
Frank got in on a double and turned the corner.
Deep,
and he turned the corner. When he turned the corner on that, I was like, oh, he's going down, and then Matt just...
And then when he did
out.
Get taken down, he just got right back up. Pretty dominant fight, too. Even that one, I was like, all right. Made up fights this weekend. This card is better than this one coming up by far. I went pay 70 for you, but I did. Because I have a problem. Jump some current events.
Sounds good.
Oh, man. I know. You guys are watching the podcast going, I have no idea what he's saying. All I can do is check out his watch. What is that? That is a Rolls-Royce of watches. What is he doing, man? Oh, I can't even. I have no idea what he's talking about, but I'm watching that timepiece on his wrist. Talking about my Vincero. Now some of you think it's Vincero. It's not, man. I'm cultured, alright? It's Vincero. Vincero watches. They make one of the best watches that are handcrafted, and they sell them at a fair price. They care about quality, top materials, small batch manufacturing. Vincero have established themselves as the best value in the industry. For this quality of a watch, you're thinking, what'd you pay for it? $100,000? $500,000? Wrong, man. Vincero is committed to over-delivering so you get a dope watch at a great price. They have 6 collections for men, 4 collections for women, and each watch is handcrafted. Some dude right now, put them together. Some dude last week, putting this watch together. Peep it. Get your time right, get your timepiece right. Vincero offers free worldwide shipping. Vincero has over 16,000 five-star reviews. People love them. Vincero watches are handcrafted to elevate your watch game. That's right, man. Right now, you guys can save 15% off by going to VinceroWatches.com. That's V-I-N-C-E-R-O Watches.com. Vincero.com. Use promo code SHAB, S-H-A-U-B. VinceroWatches.com. Listen, man, when someone goes, dude, describe your style in one word, I say Hopper. Hopper. I dress like Hopper. I look like Hopper from Netflix, Stranger Things. They go, okay, but I mean, do you mean like casual, sophisticated, playful? Are you playful? Do you want to look like Hopper? You don't? Well, guess what? There's Stitch Fix. They have an expert personal stylist that can help you guys right now. You don't want to look like a dad all goddamn day? Personal style is like a fingerprint. Everyone has their own whatever style. Stitch Fix has the expert for you. Stitch Fix, say 10 times to you, is an online personal styling service that delivers your favorite clothing brand right to your door. To get started, go to stitchfix.com/shop, S-C-H-A-U-B. Answer some questions about your style, and your personal shopper will ship you a box of clothes and shoes, accessories, so you'll be looking fly in no time. There's no commitment required, and you only pay for what you keep. Shipping, exchanges, and returns are always free. Plus, the $20 stunning fee is automatically applied towards anything you keep from your box. You never have to think about looking good again with Stitch Fix. Step your dad game up. Don't look like Hopper. Don't look like a bum. Look fly. Get started today at stitchfix.com/shop. You don't want your own personal stylist? It's so dang easy. Stitchfix.com/shop and get an extra 25% off when you keep everything in your box. That's stitchfix.com/shop. Stitchfix.com/shop.
Right,
your own personal
stylist.
see him.
The control room is just on the other side of the area.
Oh, my favorite advertisers! I'm talking about No Bull. If you go to my Instagram story, I always post my favorite workout gear, what I'm using. I'm always using No Bull. It's time to demand more from your workout gear the same way you demand for yourself. The only way I'm going to shed down from 273 is with my No Bull gear. I can't be counting on my body to go through all this work, lose all this weight. My shoes are falling apart. I can't have that. So I mess with No Bull. No Bull is footwear, apparel, accessory brand for people who train hard and don't believe in excuses. No Bull is on a mission to create products built for people who train hard day after day. No Bull doesn't believe in excuses or your bullshit. And that's why you won't find any of their footwear, apparel, or accessories anywhere where that stuff is found. No sheep are rocking No Bull. Lions only. Wear and tear is welcome. No Bull has you covered. Don't let the simple design fool you. No Bull is built to perform. I'm telling you guys, deadlift, sprints, hiking. They got running shoes coming out. They got slides. They got you covered day after day. No Bull looks good and performs. Trust your boy. They're dope looking shoes and they're great for your workouts. They got trainers, runners, apparel. They got it all. For simple, durable, functional training gear, I'm talking about real functional training gear that looks good. And when you're rocking them, the meatheads in the gym, the real workout enthusiasts go, that dude knows what's up. No Bull, that guy or girl knows what's up. No Bull. Visit NoBullProject.com/shop. Training gear for people who work hard and don't believe in excuses. Visit NoBullProject.com/shop and get your gear today. That's NoBullProject.com/shop. NoBullProject.com/shop. What do we got, man?
First one is a few messages from Max Holloway and Frank Yeager. Frank Yeager just replied today, but Max Holloway put out this really cool message on his Instagram talking about his fight with Frank Yeager.
But the goat talk always makes me cringe. Legends can't coexist. Frank was giving me the one I thought last night because that part of Frank was my father, martial arts, and just another face. I've learned from Frank Yeager, coach more Canadian now. Proud to be a Lion, proud to be honorary Canadian. If you know this sport the way his fighters know it, every champ reps a little bit of the jersey whether they like it or not because of these two legends. That's brilliant.
Yes, he encompassed Frankie and his coach.
Frank is just too old.
Yeah.
But Frankie's overall message was, you know, not to give up, he's not done, and, you know,
a lot of respect to each other.
A lot of respect. I think Frankie at 45 is done. I'd like to see him at 35.
He looked tiny and so tall.
It looked like, you know, I mean, it looked like he was two weight classes lower. So I'd love to see Frankie at 35. There's more interesting matchups there. He's not going to get another title shot at 45. It just wasn't a competitive fight. I think there's some other guys that can beat him. Obviously, Brian Ortega can beat him. So at 35, I'd be getting another title shot. Keep doing the damn thing. 35 ain't no punk either, but in his speed advantage, you go that way. You know.
Where'd you match him up again?
At 35?
35.
Man, I mean, him versus Henry Cejudo, that'd be fun.
Cody Garbrandt?
That's a great fight. Cody Garbrandt coming off a loss. Frank Yeager. Got Frank Yeager, Dominic Cruz.
Ooh, so much moving.
Yeah. Frank Yeager?
So much
Dominic Cruz, super fight? What's up, bro? I love that.
Footwork champion.
Cody Garbrandt,
that's
Dominic Cruz.
See if
Sterling,
can catch
Buffon,
into the control
Santa's a motherfucker. There's a lot of fight from there. Bomber Ice, his boys who never fight him, but.
You're very much cool.
There's a lot of. There's so many fun fights there for him.
It's all fun.
Yeah. What else we got?
Alright, so this is a fighter on that same card, Hakeem Dawodu.
Okay.
And then if you look at this weigh-in, I mean, you can see all the fighters already saying that he got away with the towel trick. So check this out.
Shred City.
You see what happened, though?
No, I don't.
So check out his hand. I'll show you right here.
Wait, but he pushes down on it.
Yeah, so check it out right here. Right there, alright? He has his hand on it. And then she lifts her hand up, he takes it off, and then as she goes down again, he puts his hand on it again.
To weigh more?
No. It lifts you up. Well, you know Daniel Cormier?
Oh, because the towel.
Yes.
Because the guys are holding it.
Oh, I didn't see what it supports your weight. Yeah. The towel supports your weight a bit, so it takes off the scale.
So this is Errol writing that this was 5 minutes to spare. This guy was barely on the edge of making it or not, so he obviously was off weight, right?
Yeah.
He ended up getting the knockout and the performance of the night. He kicked the guy in the head.
That's awesome.
That's awesome. I mean, cheating edits. I mean, that's, if you can't get caught, I mean, if you don't get caught, we're gonna die.
It's just like, I mean, it's funny to watch.
Yeah, but it's just all right.
And then the dude did end up getting.
But you know exactly what you're doing when you post that.
No, of course. Of course he knows. Yeah. That's why all the fighters are like commenting on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, well.
No, I get it.
Guess it pays.
But he probably saved, what, 0.3 pounds or some shit like that?
Barely made it, though.
Barely.
Okay, 1 pound over.
During the Daniel Cormier one, he posted a video of him doing it. It was kind of like a parody, but he actually did it, and it took off, like, I think several pounds.
No way.
It took, yeah, just like, it took, they, like, they...
Have you ever done it? Have you ever weighed yourself and put your hand on a counter? It just helps a ton.
Yeah, it's just even, like, putting your thumb, like, on a counter
or
something.
That's all aerial.
Hey, I like that he posted it.
Really?
Yeah,
dude, that's
shows.
Good shit, man.
It shows that this guy's cheating.
Yeah, it's a bitch.
Alright. That's a bitch move. What's...
He got views from it, and was like, oh, man, that guy cheated. It's fucked up.
Alright.
That's enough.
I don't know. Okay, let's get over this quick one.
Snitches get stitches.
Alright, so this is back to that sad story. Maxim. Dadashev. You know, a little quick background, he had a wife and a son in Russia, and this is the fight that, once he won, he was going to apply for a green card and bring them over. He was very, very sad. His opponent finally spoke out, and then, obviously, he says, no one's prepared to die. They're all doing it for their families, and they want to just do well. And he says, RP, Max and Dadashev. He also told, like, I guess his manager or spokesperson said that right after the fight,
because
I don't want the check.
Chances,
like, I don't want the
but
check.
You're inside the barricades. You should be able to make it the rest of the way.
And Sandy killed a guy. CBS TV, big time. But it was like millions of people watching. He killed a guy.
Was it the green guy, I think?
Yeah.
It was never the same.
It was never the same.
Because you really don't think, I know people are like, life or death is there. But really, you don't think you're going to die.
Nobody's going to say that.
Soldiers go in thinking life is death. That's a possibility. Chances of dying being a fighter are not good. It's not really life and death. It can, you know, change the chemistry in your body as far as brain trauma and broken bone and breaking jaw and, you know, torn knees and legs and stuff like that. It can change the dynamics of the quality of your life, but no one really thinks they're gonna die. It's fucking heartbreaking, man. And the guys who do end up killing people, that when they, that's gonna fuck them up mentally. Unless you're, what's his name? Krolov, the boxer, the Russian, the assassin. You don't give a fuck. Russians are a different type of animal.
Yeah. This is another one. It's very sad. It's also during the same week. A 23-year-old boxer, Alfredo Santillan. He also died. And then you can read here that right when they were reading the scorecards, he was lifting his hand up like he was winning, and then he passed out there.
Kidney failure.
Swelling of the brain. And ended up messing up his organs.
Jeez, how's it going?
23 years old, dude. It's crazy how this is happening. What? Twice in 1 week. Two young dudes. And in boxing.
So we're not afraid of them.
Okay.
Make them fear us.
Not great news, but it's not upset. BJ Penn is in talks. Or, yeah, people verbally read BJ Penn and Nick Lentz. Yeah, they know I talked about it.
I saw him defending it. It's ridiculous.
Did you see how he said it, though? He's like, man, he gave me a million reasons why he needs this fight so bad. And I said, this has to be the last one, no matter what. So yeah, he's going through some stuff, you know that.
From what I hear, they say BJ, people are worried about him when he doesn't have a fight. Like, they're so worried about his health if he doesn't have a fight to focus on. So you give BJ a fight. All you're doing is delaying whatever is next in his life. So you give him this fight, when's this fucking fight?
Are they talking September?
Okay, let's say it's September. All you're doing is delaying the downfall or demise of BJ, whatever he's going through. So now this happens in September, so then it's going to happen. Whatever he's going to do that's so horrible that we're talking about, it's going to happen 2 months later. That's all this is doing. But I guess Dana feels like he owes it to him because of what BJ did for the sport.
No.
Okay.
What is it?
It's Dana's actual, the reporter asks him about
it. But I saw him, he's like, unless you're a fucking doctor.
Yeah. Even though, the reporter's like, well, two people have died this week and brain injury.
I don't have to be a doctor.
Yeah.
I'm not a doctor. I don't work for the commission. I know he shouldn't be fighting. I know that. I don't need to be a doctor.
And then he apparently has the record for, most headshots taken. Mm-hmm. So.
And he's already showing signs of CT because of his shenanigans outside the octagon. People go, but dude, the only way he stays out of trouble is by fighting. No, I get that. But it's over. And he needs help. And the help that he needs isn't fighting inside that octagon. That's not helping him. Because I don't think it's a money issue.
eyes of BJ Penn, isn't it? That's why you gotta tip your hat to the guys and get out when it, you know, when they're, maybe you know, one or two more. I hope this doesn't happen in DC. It's just tough to sponge, man. Alright. Moving on from this. Gillian White, before she fight.
An agent needs assistance.
Ortiz and Ortiz. Doesn't matter. But in his last fight, Oscar Rivas. So he had popped for something that they haven't announced yet. But according to the UKAD, the anti-doping and the boxing thing over there, the boxing control over there, if you pop for something, I guess you don't have to be sanctioned until after everything's done. Like in the investigation, then you're also, you know, when you fight back, maybe you can get, you know, proven innocent. Until all that happens, you're not gonna get sanctioned. They didn't even tell Rivas about
Jesus
this.
Christ.
So it could take over a year even if this happened.
Hey, I wonder why Andy Ruiz Jr. doesn't want to fight
another
him in the UK.
He said straight up, yeah.
Did Andy say this? As soon as I saw this news on Dylan White, I was like, if I'm an American or just a boxer, I'm like, I'm not fucking fighting Anthony Joshua over there. Are you crazy? Dylan White, he was a big deal over there. He's no Anthony Joshua. They're letting Dylan White get away with this. What do you think Anthony Joshua's doing? You're gonna fight him over in the UK? Give him every benefit possible? Get the fuck out of here. Not a chance.
And this is Hearn's statement on it. He didn't say anything about the positive test, but he was like, they are both cleared to fight. Which is, according to their rules, they're cleared to fight.
Teddy Hearn gives me the creeps, man. Ooh. He's the Kevin Spacey of promoters. He just gives me the creeps. Chills up my spine, man.
But of course, Deontay went off on it.
Now you have a fight that's recently reported to DPDs.
Second time.
In fact, it said he's had over three home. In fact, it said he's had over more than one substance in his body. The spider they caught before DPDs. This is his second attempt. The shit has got to stop. The bleeding has to stop somewhere. We set a fighter to fucking die in the ring because of taking too many blows to the head. You have idiots like Dylan White want to cheat just to come up to the crib because he's got not gonna have to do it alone. Oscar is. This is funny that Dylan White recently on a drug in which Oscar dropped the drug user and was to beat him, so nice white. Well, I keep my money back. They don't want to fight me, but the question is, you're doping and not champion. Him and his promoter, Eddie Hearn, gave the Nipsey Bucks in hell while all of us left looking for cheating.
And he did. Dylan White did call AJ. Remember you saying that AJ's on stuff? Anthony Joshua?
Yeah,
but yeah, he's on staff.
The Zebra called up.
Explosives detected.
Oh yeah, there you go. I'm just reading that, Jesus. Oh, you hold up. A heavyweight taking steroids? That's great. We can't do it as a new guy. It's so crazy. They let him fight still. Just boxing is the most crooked of crooked, man. It's just what. What else you got,
good news. So, Robert Whitaker and Style Bender is official. The actual location of the date's official, UFC 243. And it's at Marvel Stadium in Australia, October 5th. And it has a seating of up to 60,000.
That thing is still out, man.
You know what, it's going to be the biggest Australian event and probably the biggest fight ever.
The biggest fight ever would be Holly Holm and Ronda Rousey in Australia. So Ronda got kicked in the face. Most positive, that's the biggest live. That or Toronto, either GSP, Jake Shields. What is it? Is it GSP, Jake Shields in Toronto?
Rogers.
Or yeah, the Rogers, which I was at.
That was big.
That was insane.
That was huge.
I could not see the fighters when I was in the skybox. Or was it, I think it's Holly Holm or Ronda. It's the biggest game of all time. Rousey Holm in Australia, 56,000. St. Pierre versus Shields, 55,000. Wow. UFC 196, Verdun versus Stipe, 45,000. Dude, Stylebender and Whitaker would be the biggest of all time. The UFC
sells out.
God, I'll tell you, if they did Conor versus Khabib in Dublin at, I don't know, just the country. Where's the fight at Dublin? Just Dublin. Yeah, you'd sell how many? What's their biggest arena that you'd sell them out? Yeah, Whitaker and Stalman are definitely beat that. Two superstars, both deserve it. Amazing. Can't wait for that fight. What else you got?
Chris Weidman's first fight at light heavyweight. Dominic Reyes.
Love this fight. Love everything about this fight. Great fight. It's a great test for Reyes. Great fight for Chris Weidman. It's first time at light heavyweight. I think Chris can be a real prom at light heavyweight. Here's my problem, though. I'm always biased. I always think guys are going to be better when they go up weight classes. I was wrong with Luke Rockhold. I was wrong with Max Holloway.
probably gonna be wrong with Chris Weidman, but I don't know how Chris does against Stipe and other heavyweights and other bigger dudes. He's a fucking monster. But sometimes you never know, man. Sometimes the speed just isn't there. Chris Reyes is a fucking athletic dude. It's a tough fight for Chris Weidman. But when you're a former world champion, that's what you should be getting. So, all right. Love the fight, though, for both guys.
Cool. Yair Rodriguez and Jeremy Stevens for ESPN Plus 17.
Love this one as well for both guys. Yair Rodriguez has been out for a little second, but love this fight.
In Mexico City.
Love it.
This one? How do you feel about this one? Damian Maia and Ben Askren in talks?
I absolutely love this fight. Straight up grappling match, man. Because, you know, like, Ben Askren striking just not in his repertoire. No one, hey, listen, I don't watch Damian Maia to watch him trying to outstrike guys. His strike still not good. So, usually when Damian Maia fights, if you can't get him down, you get the shitty grapplers trying to box. Doesn't go well, but Askren, we know it's going to be a grappling match. Maya knows it's going to be a grappling match. This is like a super Abu Dhabi fight on steroids. I love it. Love it. Absolutely love it. It's the perfect move for Ben. Come on for knockout loss. Damian Maia's not going to knock him out. It's a great fight.
This new one fight deal.
The UFC, but at least he's get a big fight. Yeah. One fight deal. Maybe test the water, see if they're there. I like that Nick Newell's getting a chance, though, you know?
No. Benson Henderson, so Miles Jury already has his first win. They're going to headline Bellator 227.
That's cool.
Cool. What else we got here? This is not that big of a news, but John Jones was doing an autograph signing, and Corey Anderson was sort of heckling him.
Did you hear how Dana was like, remember everyone gave me all the shit about John, that stripper, and all that stuff?
Yeah.
How he's like, you'll be fighting soon. I've seen the video. Trust me, it's not shit.
No, I haven't talked to John. I actually haven't talked to John. But, you know, I don't want to get into that whole thing, but I can tell you this. I saw some videos. John Jones will be fighting again.
You got on your phone? You want to share?
What's that?
You got the videos on your phone? Maybe you want to share them with us?
Yeah, it's sad.
Sad how?
Sad that something like that would happen to him.
Tell me.
It's hard to give John Jones the benefit of the doubt until you see the videos.
Come on! Kill me! If you can!
But yeah, and so what happened? He's on a signing. And what happened?
Corey Anderson just approached him and with his coach, too, so I'm sure he was. Series.
She was right.
And he was supposed to be like, you know, definitely signed if he won his fight. He was
want to fight, but they went for a takedown, like 10 seconds left in the round, and Dana's like, no, we're not going to sign up, because we're going to get people to finish fights and put on a show for the contender series. So then Dana White said, like, yeah, let's see if anyone else wants to sign up, and then now he signed to the PFL.
Hilarious. The PFL went, we'll take him.
Yeah.
He's a good fighter, yeah?
Yeah.
Good for him, man. I'm sure he'll make the UFC as well.
Cool. And I guess the last one is just Pacquiao and Floyd Mayweather. You know, there's rumors that there should be a rematch.
Yes.
And then, so it says that Floyd Mayweather posted this first when he was at Pacquiao's fight.
Okay.
He was in the crowd at Pacquiao's fight.
Yes. Yeah, but like I find it ironic how every time Pacquiao's name is brought up in the media, my name is always attached to it. This man's entire legacy and career has been built off its association with my name. Not true. But and it's about time y'all stop using my brand for clout, chasing clickbait, and let that man's name hold weight of its own. For years, all you heard was Floyd was afraid of Manny. But what's funny is when we finally fought, I went so easy that everyone had to eat the words of the so-called boxing experts, critics, and jealous American fan base either went mute or ran for cover or made every excuse in the world as to why I should give Manny Pacquiao a rematch. My take on all this bullshit is that y'all are just upset that I broke Rocky Marciano's record and hate the fact that a black high school dropout who can't read, I threw that in, outsmarted you all by beating all the odds and retiring undefeated while maintaining all my faculties simply by making smart choices and even smart investments. Ultimately, I always have the last laugh.
And then Pacquiao responded.
At Floyd Mayweather, you come to my fight and then use my name in a post, but I'm the one that's trying to stay relevant? If you want to be relevant again, hashtag MayPack2. They're both right. But Floyd's 100% correct. I mean, obviously, Floyd has his darkness outside the ring, and that's not cool. But as far as boxing, oh, dude, you wrote the blueprint as far as business, everything. Everyone wants to be the next Floyd Mayweather. Do you hear anyone who wants to be the next Manny Pacquiao? No one. Not that he had a bad career. Well, yeah, but in general, every single fighter points to Floyd Mayweather. Doesn't have any issues. Billionaire. Owns everything. Driving Bugattis. Fucking all the chicks. Doing the damn thing.
Girl collection.
He's a collection of girls. Everyone wants to be Floyd Mayweather. There's a reason for that. He's right,
agent,
though.
Pilot yeah,
that's
the team.
Right.
Board of 100%
is right.
What do you think about the rematch?
I'll watch it because I'm a degenerate, but I really don't care. If I'm Floyd, I don't do for what. Yeah, but you beat him. Yeah, okay, who gives a fuck? But he was hurt. Okay, beat him. That's his issue, not mine. It was what it was on the night. I can't control his health. We even let him have a shot in the shoulder, right?
Okay.
I'll watch it. Cool. Yeah, fight Sweet. I made a mistake earlier. I just realized it. I said both these were pay-per-view. This was a fight night on ESPN, thank God. Great main event, Colby Covington versus Robbie Lawler. Colby Covington sure knows how to sell a fight, though. Calls Robbie Lawler a traitor, left AK, ATT, and now I got to redeem the team. He went and became champion, they brought him back, now he's bounced. I owe it to ATT, so that narrative's fun. Tough fight for Colby Covington, man. I don't know what the odds are, but Robbie Lawler looked so goddamn good in that last fight against Ben Askren, even though he, quote-unquote, lost. The way he looked against Ben was amazing. Colby Covington striking, not great. Not, you know, it's not terrible. Definitely better than Floyd Mayweather compared to Damian Maia, but goddamn, Robbie Lawler looked good, man. It's a tough fight to pick. Super tough. Would not count Robbie Lawler out. Would definitely, he just looks, again, lost Ben Askren, but the best shape I've seen in a long-ass time. Motivated. Colby Covington not going to knock Robbie Lawler out. So he's going to have to out-grapple him for five rounds. Robbie Lawler's power and Robbie Lawler's takedown defense. Robbie Lawler can fucking wrestle too, man. Tough fight for Colby. Very tough fight for Colby. His pace, his pressure, that's what people are banking on. He breaks a lot of guys. Cardio second to none, man. Phenomenal main event. Rest of card, pure shit. Be real. At least it's free, though. Mickey Gall, a couple of notes here. Mickey Gall coming back after a bit of a layoff, and he's an underdog. They're not giving an easy fight. Jim Miller, Clay Guida. Both legends. Doesn't matter, though. But here's the thing. It's just a legacy fight, but Jim Miller, how do you not root for that guy with his kids in the crowd? He looked phenomenal in the last fight. Again, I've never rooted for someone so hard when his kids were in the crowd. It's just a dad doing dad things. Clay Guida's always one of the greats. But him versus Jim Miller, okay. It's more like one of those fights you're like, oh, I know both those guys, you know. It's a twilight fight, but I root for Jim Miller all the time. Robbie Lawler, Colby Covington, phenomenal main event.
This is a one Championship, Dawn of Heroes.
Oh, yeah.
They got this card
loaded up. You got Eddie Alvarez coming back. They also got Demetrius Johnson coming back. And it's Demetrius still in the Flyweight Grand Prix semifinals. And then Eddie Alvarez got put, even though he lost, got put in that he's still in the Lightweight Grand Prix semifinals. What time is that on?
Usually pretty early.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Good for them.
You should know Kami.
My boy.
Oh, Kami's still in it?
Yeah, Kami's only one.
That's a fine-looking man.
Welterweight.
Oh, wow. A fine-looking Japanese man.
He's built, yeah. He's probably like, taller.
His skin is the color of gold.
Yeah.
It's straight-up gold. Like, tan? Gold. I'll watch that. Good luck to my boys Eddie Alvarez and Demetrius Johnson. Dude, I like what Champion's doing. I keep saying it, man. They're taking over, slowly but surely. International's not even a contest. They fucking own the market. Is that it, dude?
That's it. Just fan questions.
Fan question. All right, guys, I'm fired up about this next one. You know, it's tough out there. When you want to lose weight or get in shape, or maybe you're in crazy shape, but you need something to track your fitness, and you've used, I'm sure, all the apps we've heard of. You've used all the fitness devices before, and it's hard to keep up with. I hear you, man, and I'm trying to get to Stretch City, not look like Hopper from Stranger Things. I'm trying to look like a swole-ass dad, and I needed some help, and I joined forces with Whoop. Whoop is a performance tool that is changing the way people track their fitness and optimize their training. Whoop provides a wrist-worn, what's up, bro? A wrist-worn heart rate monitor that pairs to their app and provides daily personal analytics and insight on recovery, strain, and sleep. So you know when your body's recovered, you know when you need to push it hard, you need to when you know to rest. It tracks your heart rate like you wouldn't believe. I'm talking your average heart rate, max heart rate, calories burned, get optimal sleep times. It tracks your sleep. It's so easy. It connects to my iPhone. I wear this thing 24/7. It lets me know how strenuous my workout is. I work out on a bike and tells me, hey, you're burning this many calories. Your heart rate's this. Mm-mm. Not true, because Whoop goes, it's actually this. So my numbers are actually on point. I know exactly how many calories to eat, how many to lose, because I know how many calories I'm burning now. No more bro science. Get it out of here. Whoop is a performance tool. You get the Whoop strap, which is a heart rate monitor that measures your heart rate 100 times per second, 24/7. 24/7. It's so easy to charge. Just put the slightest little charge on, boom, that thing's ready. And this thing lasts forever. Forever. Track your sleep. I sleep with it. It tracks your REM, your deep sleep, everything, disturbances, how much sleep you got, how much sleep you should have got, where you're at. Do you need an optimal performance? You need this much sleep. You need to just get by? You can get by with this sleep. And they just launched a new 3.0 strap. Join the club right now. Join it right now. You download the app onto your phone. This strap has a 5-day battery life, by the way. So right now, you go to whoop.com. That's whoop, W, like whoop, there it is. Whoop, there's the strap. WHOOP.com. Use the code FIGHTER at checkout and get $30 off. Optimize the way you train, the way you lift, the way you work out. Optimize your life with Whoop. That's WHOOP.com. Use the code FIGHTER at checkout. Get $30 off your Whoop membership. This episode of Below the Belt is also brought to you by the one, the only, the best supplements on planet Earth. We back, baby. I'm talking about Onnit supplements. Go to onnit.com/bigbrown. Save 10% off the best in supplements on the planet. I'm talking about Alpha Brain. Help your focus. Help your memory. Anything I do, I'm just guzzling Alpha Brain. Can't recommend that stuff enough. They got New Mood. They got melatonin spray. They got protein powder. My favorite and the one supplement that I use every single day since I've met these guys about 7 years ago, the Total Human Optimization Multivitamin, where there's a morning pack and a nighttime pack. I can't emphasize enough how important that stuff is for me. Krill oil, Shroom Tech, they got all. They got workout gear. They got minerals, spirulina. They got freaking MCT oil. They got all, man. They got gut health, which when I was having my gut health problems, I turned to them. They got the Earth Grow Nutrients. They got so much good stuff for you guys. Get started right now. Get on this train that I'm ditching this dad bod and I'm stepping to Shred City. I'm doing it with onnit.com/bigbrown to get 10% off. They got your total keto. They got keto products.
Tuck it all.
Not if you see people in person, see fans in person, or especially as a comic, you see that the narrative online isn't everything. That's not the only narrative. It's really, and I think the statistics, it's really about 10%, which is, whether it's good or bad, he shouldn't be listening to it. So for him, if he's online, he lost, he got knocked down, he's scrolling, he's like, oh my God, everyone thinks I suck. They don't. Again, A, it's not that big of a deal. B, you're not that important. Even if you're The Rock, you're Kevin Hart, you're John Jones, you're Demetrius Johnson, you lose, you're not that important in the grand scheme of things. No one's really thinking about you, man. It's your own insecurities. So just focus. Trust me, brother, it's not that big of a deal. If you won, definitely not big of a deal. What else you have?
This is from Georgie Orito Burrito. If the rematch between Cyborg and Nunes happens, how do you approach, or how does Cyborg approach the fight in terms of strategy?
Doesn't get a brawling match with her. Probably uses a little more of her grappling. Not so reckless, because Amanda Nunes has, what we saw, A, a power, she has an advantage of speed and power. So Cyborg just going there, headhunting's not going to work. Definitely a less aggressive approach.
Matt Webb, 123. What was the Chris Brown song Dana wouldn't let you walk out to?
Beautiful People.
Okay. Nate the Great, Lux, thoughts on a possible Masvidal versus Conor fight with Dana saying Conor is too small? By the way, Conor recently said he was upset about Dana saying that. Like, he's not too small.
Yeah, because he fought Nate Diaz. He's bigger than Corey. Whatever gets Conor out of bed, man, if that's the fight he wants to do, it'd be a phenomenal fight. I hope it happens for a long time. I don't think he's too small. Now you can see how Conor took him back.
Go, lady. All right, my Noah 88. In a fight today,
let's
Connor
see.
Max.
You eliminated the IED
right now.
DC.
Right now.
Secure the water treatment facility without system pressure.
Connor has
been Proteus's mission of eliminating the flooding
effect
in the reservoir.
That 145 that the killer for Connor, especially after his 55 run. So, right, Max. Max might be a slight favorite. Great fight, though. Phenomenal fight. That'd be a great comeback fight for Connor. I like that more than Masvidal. I like that way more than Khabib. I like that more than Tony Ferguson. That's a phenomenal fucking fight.
So at featherweight.
At featherweight. Even 55, they want 55
would be.
55 would be cool, too.
Alright, AGT0047. PFL has copy strike numbers on display as the fight is going. Is that something the UFC should adopt? Might help the average fan follow along better. So he's saying that they're doing it there. I haven't seen it, but.
I haven't seen it either. I like what PFL's doing. No, because sometimes copy strike doesn't mean it's not always the end all be all. I like if they had like an expert. Given the round by round, Howard Letterman? No, on Showtime. Like, all right, I got it. 9 rounds to 10. You know,
yeah.
Or whatever the fuck he does.
That is it, right? That is Letterman.
Yeah, but I would like it if they had like a, you know, a Daniel Cormier or you know, a Michael Bisping, a real fighter, cerebral. Dominic Cruz. He does it every fight, whether he calls in or he just. We don't need to hear him explain why. But just give the round by round how he sees it. Now, I don't need a judge. I don't need a fan of the sport. A real world-class mind that sees a fight and gives it every round. 10-9, 10-9, 10-0, 10-8, 10-7, whatever. That'd be cool.
Fuck
Comedy Strike.
And you should have a problem
with it. Eddie Bravo's doing it. But again, doesn't argue about striking. Super heavy base and shit too. A guy gets one takedown, or he gets taken down, but he's doing submissions off his back. Maybe Eddie's more biased towards that. No. I need a Dominic Cruz. Michael Bisping, Daniel Cormier, Uriah Faber, someone who's been there, knows the game, and is watching the fight like the fans. Gives us round by round.
Hey, Mom.
What if
just wanted to let you know that I made it back,
and
I'm fine.
Everyone's there,
and I didn't burn down.
Yeah,
and
I'll
just
get their take on
what
they want.
They were deleted 3 hours.
Anik Rogan can, but I can see, again, their cage side, anyone outside the cage, watch it like the fans. Sometimes cage side fucks up your perception.
Yeah, that's interesting, because they never really give. They'll kind of say who they think might have won the round, but they never really give 10-9 this
round. I promise to go to the health center and pick up her prescription. Anyway, just wanted to let you know I made it back and didn't get murdered on the metro. Love you. Don't forget to listen to my podcast. Prof says I need at least 50 listens to get the extra credit.
Probably a blocked punt against Kansas, where I think the game was tied. I blocked the punt, scored a touchdown. Guy named Dominic Brooks picked it up, scored a touchdown, and then it completely changed the game. Went on to blow him out, and then with Big 12 North Conference.
Nice.
Right. I'd say that one, or against CSU, I pancaked the guy so Orange Pickers could score on the goal line.
Pancaked?
Like, it's pretty well documented.
That's probably my happiest moment. The block was important because my Uncle Pax had passed away. It was the only football game he saw me play. So I'm like,
oh, wow.
Block and punt. That meant a lot.
Definitely.
What else you got?
That was it. Unless you want one more.
Sure, give me one more. We'll wrap this up.
All right, same dude. AGT0047. Does a Korean zombie versus a beat fight make sense for the opportunity to fight Max Volkanovsky winner?
I like that. Because Bronner Team, I think, is kind of like still in there.
I think Bronner Team is saying, like, show me the money.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, Brian's going to fight Mexico. He's not ready to do show me the money, is he? I hope he's paid, but... Yeah, I mean, at this point, they're going to throw any animal in there. Because there's so many guys, right? The division is so stacked. If you kind of, like, show me the money, because there's so many guys...
Something talks money walks or something like that.
Yeah, UFC is going to be very cool. We have Speed. We got Yair, we got Jeremy Stevens, we got Josh Emmett coming off the big win, Calvin Cater's on the rise, you know, so there's a lot of young, hungry guys in the plus. Ryan Hall at 14 is hilarious because I think he beat, you know, most of the guys in front of him. So there's a lot of narratives they can go there. So if you play hardball, I don't know how that ends for you.
Yeah.
Hopefully it's paid, though. That's it. Boom, boom, boom. This week, man, I'm off to one of my favorite cities, one of my favorite clubs, Zanies, Nashville. I'm super excited for this one. Zanies this Thursday, Friday, Saturday. One show Thursday, two shows Friday, two shows Saturday. I will be with my partners in crime, Asan Ahmad and Derek Poston, the Comedy Store Door guys who are hilarious comics. They will be with me this Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Nashville, Zanies. Get you some. Looking forward to seeing you. Unfortunately, I won't be having Hattie's chicken because I'm on this diet, so it should be interesting.
Chicken, right?
Breaded fried chicken. Can't eat it, dude. Rather not have it, Chin, you know? I don't want to pick the bread off like a psycho. Probably just skip it, you know? I go to Nashville. Then August 15th through the 17th, I'm in Portland. Portland, Oregon. Right? Yes. That's another one of my favorite clubs. The Helium. Portland Helium. Again, can't have Voodoo Donuts, can I? So that's going to be tough for your boy here. But I don't want to look like Hopper, so it's worth it. So Nashville this week. And then August 15th through the 17th, I'm at the Helium in Portland, looking forward to it. And then just announced Gold Country Casino in Oroville, California. No idea where that's at. I just know me and Brian are coming. You're getting one night of a combo show from Brian and myself, all stand-up. And that is August 31st, one night, Oroville, California. No idea where that's at. Whatever. Then on September 20th and 21st, I'm in Houston, and then Denver after that. Get your tickets now for Nashville and Portland, tfatk.com. Get them, fam. Oh, also in Nashville, if you've seen the graphic that we made from the whiskey bottle of Jack Daniels, they did Zany's B-Shop logo. It's dope. I got hats coming. I got t-shirts coming. I had King Sting. The whole merch table is going to be lit out there. J-Shop will be out there. That's for Portland as well. There's going to be some cool shit. Can only get in person in Nashville, though. TFATK.com for everything else, tickets-wise. Nashville, see you this week. Thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. I love you guys. Thanks for subscribing. I'm all over Tuesday night. If you're listening to this, Tuesday night, I'm at the Improv and Comedy Store. I think Improv, late show, 10:30, Comedy Store, 8 p.m. Get tickets if you're in Los Angeles. I will be there with some very funny people. All right, guys. Thanks for listening. Until next time. Love you. Keto dads out there, let's do this. Don't look like Hopper. 273. I'm sorry.
So I apologize if I was late and we missed Jeff Neal. That's my fault. And I hope we talk to him because he looks so good on Saturday against Eagle Price. I would hate to not talk to Jeff Neal.
Fun fight.
It was. It was really, really great.
Tough for me to watch Frankie lose.
Yeah.
It's the only time I allow myself to be impartial a little bit. That's my favorite fight.
Frankie is.
Yeah.
I picked Max by decision, but let me know when Jeremy is on. But it was only because I thought that the 10 years younger and the reach would be
100%. You know what's crazy, too, is that you... Oh, is that Jeremy?
I think we have Jeremy right now. Hi, Jeremy. How you doing?
Fantastic. How are you guys?
What's up, Jeremy? This is Phoenix Fun Valley, and you know Jim Norton.
Yeah. How we doing?
Very, very good. We haven't talked to you in a little while. Now, you're getting ready to fight Yair Rodriguez, who had that amazing ending against the Korean Zombie. But I think the fight before that was against Frankie Edgar, if I'm remembering correctly, which I'm sure that's the one that you probably concentrated on more.
Yep. I've seen both. I've watched and studied both tapes.
And when you watched the Edgar, you know, because Frankie is so good, again, such a veteran, taking a guy who probably hasn't faced anybody like him down that way, what did you see watching that Frankie Edgar fight, and what did you think that Yair did wrong or Frankie did right?
I saw a cat playing with a mouse.
Yeah.
That boy is green. Yair is so green.
Wrestling wise, you mean?
Just in fighting in general. You know, he's a special kid. He's got the kicks and stuff. But you know, I can go to a karate school and find all types of kids like that. Who can spin, do double flips, and probably spin a cap off the bottle like you've been seeing. As far as fighting, you know, it's a different game. As you can tell, Frankie was able just to dominate him on the ground. You know, if I take you down on the ground, I'm going to elbow you and split your head open and just try to get out of there as quick as possible. And I'm stronger, I'm meaner.
Agent, Pilot Torres is cleared for transport to Kenley College.
A ton of experience of being in there, and especially fighting a guy who I feel better than him just recently in my last fight. So we're preparing for the challenge, and we're ready to kick his ass.
Well, that's kind of what I was going to ask you, too, about Zabit. He's a very, very unpredictable fighter. He throws a lot of different things at you. He seems like a harder guy to train for. Does Yair have any of that, in your opinion?
Yeah, they run. That's really what it comes down to. Guys like Max, he didn't fight Frankie and Aldo and a lot of other guys. These guys run for me. They fear my power, whether I hit you in the chest or in the toe. You're going to run. You're going to feel the power. I'm expecting that, so I feel like I can make the adjustments and capitalize a little bit better than I did even in my last fight. I feel like it could have went my way. There's a few things that I can easily take and work on that, and then I'm going in there and I'm fighting a guy who doesn't have the wrestling, or I feel like does he have the pop of the beat. You know, it's there. There's some stuff to look out for definitely, but you know, I'm more worried, focused on what I'm going to do. And that's going to be mean and nasty and rough this young kid up.
Dominic Cruz was giving an assessment of you during that Zabit fight, and he said that your power was a little bit of a gift and a curse because you load up, and he said that might have been a little bit of the problem when you had to sort of chase Zabit around. Did you listen to his assessment of you, and what did you think of it?
Yeah, I immediately saw him after for my after party. We met, and I go, man, like, give me some feedback. And he's like, bro, you look great. You look great. Kept telling me I look great. I go, no, motherfucker, tell me what do I need to do, because I need to beat these guys. I'll be champion. You know, really what it comes down to is these guys just kind of pointed me, and that's it. It's like no one beats my ass. Like, no. I would have rather gone in there and had to beat my ass, hold me down like Frankie did Yair, and do it. And it's like I'm losing just these little millimeter, tiny little details. And he's like, just some footwork and volume. And I totally agree. I was like, man, I should have kicked a little bit more. No excuses. I kind of had a foot injury during camp, so I didn't really feel comfortable letting my kicks go, and it ended up costing me. So, going back to good health and assessing everything, the footwork, and just dialing everything in, I know I can make the adjustments. Like I said, I was just in 15 minutes in a fight with somebody who's wild like that. And I held my own. I was able to avoid that flashy shit and put pressure on him so much that he was running. He literally would have ran out of the stadium if they would unlock the cage. So I'm ready for this next opportunity. And I'm gonna make the adjustments and go have a good night in Mexico and enjoy some margaritas and fajitas after.
Now the Yair fight again against the Korean Zombie. I know it was with 1 second left. Am I remembering that right? Because I remember thinking Yair was losing that fight. And being shocked at that, or is that too close to call?
I think it was very close because of Yair's kicks. I could be wrong, but the Korean zombie was definitely on him.
Yeah, for some reason I thought he was losing that fight, and that was just, not a lucky punch, it was a great elbow either.
Yeah,
and you've never fought in Mexico, correct?
Nope, never fought in Mexico, but I've enjoyed some good times in Mexico, that's for sure.
Yeah, right?
Where did you prepare and train for this, and are you concerned with the altitude, though?
No, not at all. I'm actually excited. I'm gonna head down there here real soon. So I'm excited to step into a new journey and create a new path that no one else has been on. I welcome it. You know, I'm part Mexican, so I enjoy the culture. I enjoy being down there with the most respectful people in the world and just smelling all the street tacos. And you know, I can't wait to be up there in the mountains and just really embracing like the Rocky vibe. So
yeah.
I'm excited to go there and be around the people and really embrace the culture and go on a new path.
Jeremy, I what I love about you, honestly, especially the last couple of interviews that you've had and your just openness, and one thing that you said, you used something that is a term that's usually used in boxing a lot, which is that you were gonna fight Mexican style, which I mean to me that generally means like war and a lot of action. Can you explain to some of the MMA fans who might not know that term what it means to fight Mexican style?
Watch my highlight tape. Watch it. Mexican style to me is, you know, this kid's a runner. You know, he doesn't fight Mexican style. As compared, I'm only 25%, and I fight full 1,000% Aztec warrior Mexican style. That means I'm coming to take your head off. I'm gonna beat up your leg. I'm gonna beat up your body. I'm gonna stuff your takedowns. I'm gonna avoid your kicks, and I'm gonna throw heat until I knock you the fuck out. And if I don't knock you out, you're gonna be beaten so bad that you're gonna want to quit on the stool every round that you come out. And that's the Mexican style. That's the Mexican spirit. That's the fight that I bring to the table. And if you don't believe me, just watch my highlight tape.
And I'm guessing you've worked on too. If Zabit ran, and you know that Yair, like you said, might want to back away and stay away from you, you obviously have had to work on something to either cut the cage down or to cut them off and to stop that movement.
Yeah, I felt like I was cut off good. I could have just used a little bit more volume, just throwing a couple more punches, even when I'm missing, because my last, like, I would throw 3-4 punches in my...
Agent, Pilot Torres is cleared for transpro to Kenley College.
Safe area entered.
Sir, civilians are not permitted beyond this point.
I'm trying to find my wife. She was assigned here.
Then I'm sorry. This is a quarantine zone.
She's a nurse, not a patient.
All personnel are required to remain inside the perimeter until further notice.
You can't keep people locked up in there.
The staff will fully believe.
agents group.
On the land on the beat, and he didn't like it. He kept on his course. This round, I get five rounds. Honestly, you know, the beat didn't kick me in the nuts in the first round. He did a really good break. He hit me hard in the nuts, and he tried to like steal the round, jumping off, trying to be flashy. But I broke him and made him like look up at the clock and say, like, man, this kid keeps coming, keep coming. This young kid, he gasps pretty much every time. He's tired in the Korean zombie fight. Korean zombie made mistakes, slapping high fives with this young kid. You might slap high fives or slap my shit across your face. And keep putting the pressure on you. And like, I'm going to break you if I don't, I'm not worried about cutting him off. He can run. But in those fourth and fifth rounds where I've been, many times, I will definitely break you. Like I said, if I don't knock you out, I'm gonna break you. You're gonna be looking up for the clock. You'll be looking for your coaches. You'll ask them, what time is it? Like, how does this kid keep coming? That's that Mexican style that I bring to the table. I don't stop. I don't give up. Tear off half my face, my leg. I'm still gonna come and try to take you out, kill you.
Can I ask a stupid, like, girl question? So I obviously don't have nuts. So I can't, you know, comment on it, but I'm
you
wondering.
Did, I date you.
But I'm wondering if this. So no, it's a weird perspective. You guys get up to 5 minutes. No one ever really uses it, even though obviously a kick to the nuts, it really affects you. It affects you in the fight. It bothers you for a significant time after. Is the reason why nobody takes the full 5 minutes because you're afraid to cool down too much? Like, what really goes on? What, you get kicked really hard in the nuts, and then you decide to get back in there?
Sometimes, like, they like a guy like to be, like, I know if I keep pressure, he'll break and he'll gas out because he uses a lot of flashy stuff and then he was running. Normally, if I get hit in the nuts and, like, I know that this guy's going to break, I'll kind of, like, if I can, I'll just shake it off and keep going because I know the pressure. That one, I took a hard shot to the nuts and I was like, damn, this hurts. And that one really affected me, so I had to take almost three minutes.
Yeah.
And then at the end, he tried to do some flashy stuff, tried to stole the round, which he possibly could have. That's kind of where I feel like that was the difference. If I didn't get hit so hard there, I probably just kept brushing it off and kept going, putting that pressure on it because he was getting so tired toward the end of the fight. I mean, it hurt. I mean, there's no way or anything around it. You know, it happens. I don't think he meant to do it on purpose or anything like that. Good shot.
You can't even really describe how much it hurt. Like, to someone who doesn't have testicles, when you get hit in the balls with anything, it's like standing in smoke. Like, it's just there. Like, every part of you hurts, your head hurts, your fingers. It's just an awful thing. And you mentioned, too, something that was an issue was the high-fiving in the middle of the cage. We interviewed somebody recently, and I don't remember who it was, who was saying how much he hated that. And I like when guys have mutual respect, but how do you feel about that, like when it's in the middle of a fight or the beginning of third round, when guys are too friendly?
I don't like it. We may shake hands before, we may shake hands after. We may take a picture together and shit. We might have some beers at a party in Tennessee, but we're not friends. We're not friends. This business. I don't have any friends in this sport.
Abuse, we live here, we live there. You know, when you share that with somebody, it actually connects you. Then it might
might help someone else open up and be like, man, these things are happening to me. If they made it, maybe I can make it. So there's so much power in that to share and just let alone. You're not hanging on to that bullshit.
Right.
And telling yourself a story like, hey, I was a young kid from Iowa, you know, I had a messed up childhood. Like, I stopped telling myself that story of why I cannot make it, because now that I look back, I'm like, look what I can do. I'm powerful. I'm courageous. I'm a smart dude, you know. Like, fighting isn't something that's gonna last forever. It's just a mechanism, a tool for me to use to set myself up. You know, I'm always gonna fight, though. We always have that fighting spirit.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and when you share them things with people and you actually open up, you develop a stronger bond. You let people know that, hey, this isn't the end. You know, you give them hope. You give them inspiration. And to me, that's more powerful than holding some shit in and acting tough.
Were you always teaching me with this stuff?
Sorry, real quick. But at the end of the day, you know I'm tough, right?
Yeah.
Like, you know what? You just watch my shit, but you're just a badass dude. But if I was to tell you, like, hey, some fucked up shit happened to me as a kid, or hey, I was going through this, or I was battling this, people, like, when I opened up about that, they're like, wow, man, thank you. I even went back to my hometown, had people, just regular workers, saying, hey, man, I really appreciate you sharing, because, you know, I've gone through the same stuff, and this and that, this and that. And to me, I'm like, I sit there and I listen to them, I go, wow. You know, like, we're human beings. Like, everybody has, like, that shit in their head, that bullshit story that they tell themselves.
Yeah, it's almost more rewarding than just entertaining them with fighting, is being able to share and inspire.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, you know, when people would tell me, like, when they're rich and they have flashy cars and big houses, I was like, damn, you know, I got married recently, I bought a fucking tremendous house, I had close to $1 million in my bank account, and I was fucking not happy.
Wow.
Like, it made me kind of weird, but I was like, dude, this is what they're talking about, this is that feeling. And it wasn't until I actually went there, shared some stories, kind of like we were just talking about, got into a deep level. I was in a classroom, I didn't knock nobody out, I didn't have money in my bank account, like, I just felt pure happiness and joy within myself. And that's where I was like, this shit is powerful. You know, this is the true power of this is what it's really like to be happy, to be fulfilled, to really know what my purpose is. I didn't even know I even had a fucking purpose.
Wow.
Just not to be wild because I liked it, but like, now I know my purpose. You know, and it's, my purpose is to give back to the young troubled youth that are just like me, or maybe they're out there and they don't know how to open up. They don't know how to be vulnerable. You know, I've been going to high school and speaking for like 3 hours to like multiple different students, sharing my story. You know, and they're in high school. They may be like not wanting to hear me trying to act cool, but I know deep down that I'm reaching out to some of those little people that really need to hear it. So
you can get very comfortable feeling depressed too. There's a chemical feeling you get where it's almost like wearing like a blanket over your shoulders, and it can become a really comfortable and familiar place to be.
Who wants to be sad or feel like, hey, I can't even reach out to my mom or my dad and talk to them and tell them sorry or try to understand like maybe what they've gone through in life and why they act the way that they do. You know, we always hold things so personal, and they can just go on and on, but,
security,
you know,
don't
hold that shit in, because it'll just ruin you and beat you down until maybe, you know, you actually pull the trigger, or, you know, you may jump off the bridge and none. There's love from, you know, depression. You know,
yeah.
Love has no limits, man. I've seen love, you know, overpower anything. You know, it's just, you just let it.
Yeah, I mean, shame. Shame is at the root of most of that stuff that most people suffer from, and you know, shame is it's a bitch.
Yeah, I mean, Jeremy, any predictions you want to give us before you go?
For my fight?
Yeah.
Tune in and don't blink.
awesome. Thank you so much. You are savage.
Always good talking to you, man. September 21st in Mexico City, the main event, yourself against Yair Rodriguez. Have a good camp, and we'll talk to you soon.
Thank you guys so much. I really appreciate the talk. That was awesome.
Awesome.
Thank you guys, and I hope to see you guys soon.
Absolutely.
Next to Mexico, drinking margaritas and the heat as much.
I would love that.
Take care, man.
Thanks.
Infiltrating terminal.
If you want to step it up in the bedroom, you need a Blue Chew. It'll get you wrapped up and ready in the sack
system,
so you can improve your performance and gain that confidence you might be missing. Blue Chew brings the first chewable with the same FDA-approved active ingredient as Viagra and Cialis. That's how you know it works.
You know who loves Blue Chew? Me and my wife love Blue Chew.
I just want to add that in. I love Blue Chew, and so does my wife. She's not going to tell you, and you know, I'm not going to tell her I take it. But listen to me. I love Blue Chew, and so does my wife. Go ahead, Phoenix.
Take it anytime, day or night, and rise up, you know what I'm saying. Whenever the mood strikes, it's not just for guys who can't perform. It's for anyone who wants to perform better and last longer in bed. Just go to BlueChew.com. That's Blue Chew like blue color. It's prescribed online and shipped to you in a discreet package, so nobody has to know about it, baby. No one needs to know about your dick bill.
Right now, we've got a special deal for Unfiltered listeners. Visit BlueChew.com and get your first shipment free when you use our special promo code UFC. Just pay the $5 shipping. Again, that's BLUEChew.com. Promo code UFC to try it for free.
And impress her with your performance.
You don't know what you've got until it's gone. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? Hair. People, two out of three guys are going to experience hair loss by the time they're 35, but Keeps is the easiest and most affordable way to keep the hair you have, huh? Elbow to the ribs, you. FDA-approved hair loss products are finally inexpensive and easy to get. Signing up takes less than 5 minutes. To get started, you answer a few questions, snap some photos to complete your online consultation. A licensed physician will review your info online and recommend the right treatment for you. They ship right to your door every 3 months, so you don't have to go to the pharmacy and stand in line behind irritating people. It only costs $10 to $35 a month. Plus, and now you can get your first month for free. First of all, $10 to $35 bucks a month is not much. You probably spend that much on hats, or on comb-overs, or on stupid hairspray, or on, like, loud pants so people don't look at your embarrassing head. Fix it already. One hell of a deal for getting to keep your hair. Keeps is hooking me up with a trial. I'm excited to try it out, because, look, I don't have a lot of hair loss, but I do have enough to be concerned. Just reading the reviews online, looking at the before and after pictures, I mean, this stuff, it works. If you suffer from hair loss, the last thing you need is to wait to see your doctor. With Keeps, there's finally a way to get the help you need when you need it. For a limited time, receive your first month of treatment for free. Then you go to Keeps.com, spelled exactly the way you think. KEEPS.com/UFC. KEEPS.com/UFC. You get your first month for free. Yeah, I like hearing guys like that talk about depression, because a lot of guys don't talk about it. A lot of people, like, you know, public figures, especially fighters, like you said, it is like a feminine quality to be in touch with your feelings, or something, the misconception. So to hear that is, it's really helpful to a lot of people. Uriah, I think Uriah Hall talks to us a lot about that stuff, too, about feeling afraid and having all these feelings that a lot of fighters don't like to talk about.
Well, there's a lot of different psychological types that take to fighting. A lot of it is people with less inhibitions, adrenaline junkies, obsessive compulsive disorder. Those are all types of things that, you know, look this type of person is attracted to athleticism. So it's tough because you're going off the highs and lows all the time. You're literally above average highs and, like, below average lows when you lose.
Yep. Well, let's talk to Jeff Neal. Are you going to call in or no? We're hoping we can get him. What an impressive win.
Damn.
That was, and of course, Matt and myself both had Nico Price.
Really?
Yeah, I think Nico had lost two straight. I just didn't see him losing a third straight. Sometimes I'll go like that with a guy, as again, as much who likes to be in the mix as he does, and just stand there and slug it out. He's so unpredictable and hard. I know Jeff Neal is very strong, and he's, I think, undefeated in the UFC. But again, certain guys, you just don't see them losing more than two in a row. Like Jeremy Stephens, I'm probably going to take in this fight. I don't see him losing three straight.
Yeah, I hope to see him. I hope to see him win, too, because I feel like I want his message to get out there more, and if he's on a winning streak, you know, he'll be out there a little bit more. He's never really into being in the media, and now I feel like he's a lot more open, and which is cool, you know, which is really cool.
And now it looks like Cyborg is going to fight Amanda again, even though, you know, I thought Cyborg looked great. Felicia Spencer, I just thought was tough. But I thought Cyborg looked incredible. Even though she couldn't put her away, I thought she looked really, really great. She didn't stay up against the fence that long. She would get pushed up again. She managed to turn out of it. And I thought her punching was accurate. She was ferocious. She just couldn't knock her out.
Yeah, it's just a style thing with her and Nunes. Because Nunes capitalizes off of Cyborg bum rushing. And that's really what it is. It's, you could be the greatest fighter in the world, but style versus style, sometimes somebody gets the answer for you.
Right.
And people always say, well, what are the holes in their game? What do they they do wrong. It's not necessarily that they do anything wrong and there's holes. It's just that there's a combative answer to somebody's habits. And I think that's part of that whole matchup.
And it's rare that there's a guy like John Jones where there seems to be no answer. Or I mean, there is. Someone's got it. Somebody will be in unless he retires.
Yeah.
Or a guy like Israel Adesanya, like... these guys where it seems like everything that would be considered a style problem winds up being a bigger style problem for the guy they're fighting.
Well, he's obsessive and he adjusts on the fly and he watches a lot of film and, you know, he's not given enough credit for his fight IQ.
John,
he's not. There was a couple of people I would love to watch a fight with just to hear what they have to say as they're watching, they break things down. Conor McGregor, who I don't know if I can handle his personality for more than 10 minutes, but I would like to watch a fight with him. And John, I would love to see how he breaks down fights. And also, Valentina Shevchenko. Because I'm like, what are you seeing as your opponent's moving that you find opening? So,
well, McGregor, I'll tell you what about McGregor. Sometimes he's difficult, but I like him after he loses because he takes a loss well. He handles it like a professional. He beat me. What am I gonna do? You know, he gives credit to the guy who beat him. I always like him after he loses more. Like, you know, he'll stand and promote a fight. But I think I can tell a lot more whether I like a guy or don't like a guy after he.
Yeah, he's humble in defeat, which does for most people makes it more interesting or almost forgivable. But the whole bus thing still pisses me off.
It's always terrible. Now, Dana had said he thinks she's afraid to fight Amanda again. I don't know if he was just kind of taunting her or trying to just poke her so she did fight her, but this was the last fight of her contract, I think, was this Spencer fight, and I think she is going to fight Amanda again. And she has a bit of a contentious relationship with Dana, and I don't know why. She said, Dana,
I remember why. Like, look, I love Dana for his honesty and his sense of humor and him just, like, saying whatever he thinks on his mind. But the problem is when you're a public figure, whatever you say, even though you just said it as a joke or you said it instantly, lives forever. And then if you have people fan out on you, they take what you say and then they run with it. Well, he might have said something just to jest for a quick second. He said that she looked like Vandalay Silva in the dress.
Oh,
and like
he was making fun of
something else. And now,
was that before she was in the UFC?
It was. And then something else, and then now she says that her kids were being bullied and, you know. But kids are like that, regardless of what Dana White says. They're fucked up, and you know that. But I think that kind of never sat with her well. And then they forgave each other, but the contracts, and I don't know what goes on behind the scenes.
Everybody wants for money, and there's not many people she can't fight because of the weight class. I mean, there's just not many options. For her, and Durandamé didn't fight her. I wonder if she will now. I mean, she said it was because she had, I think, tested dirty or something. But
a million years ago.
There's also one of those things, too, where I think that, you know, you look at a cyborg and a lot of people just don't want to deal with that in the cage.
Possibly. I mean, she's never really said no to any fight before, especially in her kickboxing career, so it's weird to me that just cyborg of all people. And a lot of these kickboxing organizations don't test, so it's, I don't know, it's just a weird moral thing, or I have no idea. I don't know.
Maybe. I mean, I like Jermaine, we've interviewed her. I mean, I think she's great, but I don't know. I think maybe, but I don't think you refuse to fight, you know, one of the, if not the biggest name in women's MMA because of something that happened a long time ago.
Right, especially if you're building your own brand. It just, that's a super fight right there.
So what do you think, obviously, Holloway against Edgar. I took Holloway, only because, I mean, Frankie has lost a few title fights, which I want to talk about. I think they said it was like five straight, I think, in a row.
Yeah.
Well, five straight would have covered it if I didn't say in a row, like an asshole, we got it, Jim. But I get
it. It's like ATM machine.
Yeah, you're right. But I gave the edge to Max just because I didn't see him losing twice in a row, and he just lost to Poirier. And I also thought that the 10 years difference, because the cardio for Edgar is amazing. But Max also has great cardio, and Max is really hard to get in on. And Brian Ortega showed you that no matter how good you are on the ground, you have to get him on the ground first. And he is, I don't know if there's anybody harder in the UFC to take down. There shouldn't have been no fucking 10 tweets will come up and how stupid I am.
Well, Aldo has always been very difficult to take down, and Frankie took him down twice and whatever. But I would say that. You know what it is?
Aldo was a black belt, I think, too. Yeah. I wonder what is Max's jiu-jitsu?
I think brown belt or a black belt. He might have recently got his black belt. Frankie, I know it's a black belt. But the thing is that Max, I thought Max had this ridiculous reach. He doesn't. He is just so good at stepping back and keeping you at the edge of his punches. And that's what it is. He knows how to just keep you, like, just line them up straight and keep you at the edge of them. And that's why he's so difficult. And I don't know who's getting around that.
Well, he had 5 inches of height on Edgar, who I think was 5'6" or 5'11". That's what I'd ask.
Yeah.
What is the reach difference?
I think an inch. Yeah.
Wow, is that it? Okay,
yes.
You know what?
Isn't that crazy?
It's just his distance management and maybe his height makes him have the appearance because he's not as, like, they weigh the same, so.
Right.
Maybe he looks like he's a ganglier guy.
Everybody says Frankie's too small for that weight, and it's like, I don't know. I don't know what to think. I really don't.
Why is he lost? Because he's always, I mean, again, the Ortega fight was the one time he gets called an uppercut because he's coming in.
Right.
But he doesn't, he's obviously not choking. He's not a Is he pulling back a little bit? Is he saving a little too much for the later rounds? Is he being slightly more cautious because of what's on the line? He's obviously fighting the best in the world.
I think that's it.
But Frankie's one of the best in the world. I don't think that every guy who beat him just beat him simply because he's better than him. But I think Frankie is good enough to have beaten any of those guys.
Listen, I agree. He's my favorite fighter of all time. I just don't know. I don't know. I would have to watch that fight again and take a look at it. I just feel like Max always seems to be one step ahead and keeps people at the end of his punches. And Frankie did get in many, many times. But I will say this, that was the most frustrated I've ever seen Frankie. Because I felt like after a round, he knew he had lost it and his heart was breaking a little bit each and every time. I was the most frustrated I've ever seen.
Yeah, and maybe Max just frustrated because he couldn't take him down. I mean, was he 1-for-9 or 1-for-10 or something? I mean, he had a really hard time getting Max to the ground. So maybe that was it. Maybe Max was harder to take down than he thought. I mean, I'm sure he knew it was not going to be a Yair Rodriguez situation. But he had to know from watching Ortega that Max is really fucking good at keeping you from
going
hard.
And Frankie has great footwork, too. Frankie has great footwork, too.
The first couple rounds were interesting watching those guys just kind of float in and out and dance around each other because both of them are so fast, so good on their feet.
I feel like Max might do a whole bunch of double end bag work or whatever because he's just finds your head. And you don't see him, his accuracy is really on point. He just finds your head in motion because that's what Frankie's so good at, angling out a little bit. But, you know, again, everybody becomes predictable after a significant time, especially if you've been around a really long time.
That's the disadvantage to having over 6 hours, 7 hours now in the octagon, is that there's a lot of tape to watch.
A lot to watch, right.
And you've had enough losses where you can go, oh, okay, even in a decision, this is what he'll tend to do by the third round. Yeah, I guess so. But then again, Max has a lot on him, too. There's a lot to see.
Yeah.
But Max just seems almost unbeatable right now.
I don't know. Is it an age thing? So many variables.
The 10 years
makes
a difference. Sure. No matter how good you are, that's a lot of time. That's a lot of fucking time. I mean, what's the age between Cormier is what, 40 or 41 right now?
He's 41.
I mean, Stipe is close to that. I think Stipe is what? You got
like
Jeff?
37? Is he?
We have him. Jeff. Hey, buddy, how are you?
What's up, Jeff?
I'm worried.
I don't know. Very good. The reason we weren't able to talk is because there was a technical difficulty. Me as an ass, I didn't get here on time. Not realizing it was at 12:15, so I apologize for making you wait.
You don't eat it.
No, it's all good. I wasn't doing anything anyway.
Oh, okay. How are you feeling, man? That was a really, really great win over a very, very tough guy.
It's just another step, you know. I'm not ready for whatever comes next.
What comes with that performance of the night, $50,000? What happens with that? What's your first investment?
Yeah, exactly. I'm going to keep it in the bank and figure out what I want to do with it later.
By the way, I erroneously said I thought Nico Price had lost that and didn't see him losing two in a row, three in a row. Incorrect. Nico had not lost. He was coming off. He was coming off a win. After that first round, was that when you went down in the first round? Was that more the left or was that more the headbutt?
He had hit me with the left as I was hitting him with the left, and I guess the momentum from it, like from both the punches, it pushed our heads together, and then the headbutt is what really dropped.
It was like the end of Rocky too, though, watching two guys go down at the same time.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
How badly were you hurt? Because you looked a little wobbled. I think he threw a right kick that you to the head, which you stopped with the glove. up, and it seemed like it's still connected. And you looked a little dazed by that. How hurt were you at that point?
At that point, like, I was more mainly off balance. Like, when he threw the kick, and it kind of threw off my footing a little bit, and I tried to circle out, and that's when he had threw the lunging left hook. And I was trying to counter him on that, and that didn't work out too well.
And was he difficult to prepare for? Because, again, he is unpredictable. He throws a lot of stuff at you. We just talked to Jeremy Stevens about guys like Zabit and Yair Rodriguez, who also do that. Was it difficult to prepare for a guy like this?
Yeah, 100%. I've been training. I was training and preparing for, like, you know what I mean? Like, all my training partners are real technical. And, like, you know what I mean? Like, they have technical boxing, technical kickboxing, and nothing about the code. I was thinking that technical-footed.
Twitter, but now there's Twitter, so guys can start going out. Almost- He would have been amazing on Twitter, but that's what it is. It gets people interested, and when the fans start asking for fights, it seems like the UFC is pretty good at giving people the fights that they want to see.
Algorithms and metrics, man. You see the metrics when two people start talking to each other, and, you know, I have mixed emotions about that, though. Because for me, it's always about if I like the matchup. I don't really care what anybody else says to anybody. So, Jeff, for you, you know, you're very well-rounded, but how would you describe your style, then?
I spent my style as just, calm and calculated, you know, honestly, I feel like I have to do anything. I can knock a ball, I can, wrestle, you. I can pinpoint strike, you know, I really have no style, to be honest.
So when you think about, like, what kind of fight you'd like to be in, is there anybody within your division that's like, oh, that would be a cool challenge, or that would be fun to do a weight day fight?
A good matchup for, like, me and the fans would be me versus Luke. That would be a great fight.
I think you're right. I do think you're right.
Yeah. And when you look at the top of the division, too, I mean, and then you think, all right, you have to get ready eventually for guys like Kamaru Usman. To see Tyron Woodley manhandled for 5 rounds, I never thought I'd see that. I mean, I knew he could lose, but I never thought I would see anybody dominate him on the ground like that.
I also think he was burned out, though.
Yeah, he might have been.
Yeah.
But that's still a tremendous, I mean, you know, to take somebody's belt and beat them basically, I want to say 50-45,
right.
I mean, that was completely dominant. I mean, how do you look at that? How do you look at the top five of the division?
The top five of the division is real tough, and it's real wrestling heavy, so I just got to make sure my wrestling is on point for that, because everybody's top five has great wrestling.
You got the right coach for it.
Yeah, I got the perfect coach for it.
Yeah.
And Covington fighting Robbie Lawler this week. You know, a lot of people don't like Colby Covington because he has a big mouth, but, I mean, people forget he's an extremely smart and effective fighter. What do you think of that this weekend?
I want Robbie to win, but I just really don't know how his cardio is going to hold up with Covington, because I've never seen him, Covington, get tired in a fight, and he'll wrestle constantly the whole fight, so he might blow off the decision.
Yeah, he is relentless. Now, how long have you only been fighting? Like, when's the last time you had a job that was not fighting to supplement your income?
I've been working my whole time. I've been fighting. I'm a server and a bartender, so.
Oh, you still are? Okay, I didn't realize you were still.
But how crazy is that? If I didn't know you and I'm at a bar and I'm sitting in Dallas and I order something, and you come up to me, I'm gonna be like, there's no way that's Jeff Neal. does that happen to you? Did people go, excuse me, are you an MMA fighter?
It really doesn't happen that frequent, because I just recently got to UFC like 2 years ago, so this fight was probably like my highest profile fight as far as like exposure, so I really haven't got too much of that. The only people that really recognize me as a real hardcore MMA fan.
You can get more tips now.
I don't know, or less tips.
Imagine starting shit at Jeff's bar. Like, you don't know who the bartender is.
Right.
Start a problem.
Right.
Do they all know you fight? Now, do they expect you to kind of be like a go-to bouncer as well?
Sometimes they'll like look at me like when something's about to go down. I'm like, hey, Jeff. And now I just walk away because I don't have time for that. Like, I don't pay me enough.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, I mean, you don't want to. Hey, the schedule get hard too, because the nightlife, the bartender, you're working at night and you got to get up in the morning and train. So how does that affect your, is that kind of counterproductive to your schedule, or are you able to do both?
I'm able to do both. It sucks. It really sucks. I give you an example, on Friday, I wake up in the morning, I have to condition it, and then I'll go to work at 11 a.m. right after that, and then I'll be at work until 2 a.m., get to bed at like 4, and then have to wake up again tomorrow, but it's hard, like, the first couple weeks, but once you get in that groove, get in the rhythm, then
you gotta get sleep. That's when your HGH, your natural HGH, happens when you're sleeping. So for athletes and fighters, it's really important. It's even if, like, you train and you just take a 2-hour nap after you train, you're repairing your body much more.
I'm a terrible sleeper, so don't think that I, as a 51-year-old lump, am comparing myself to Jeff Neal as a man. But I walk up a flight of steps sometimes and I feel like my legs have no blood in them, but I think that's part of not sleeping.
It's 100%.
It is, right?
So yeah, we'll talk about this. So when we're off the air, I'm going to try to help Jim, you know, get him some GABA, some natural supplements or whatever the fuck, so he can sleep well.
I'm a terrible sleeper. I have sleep apnea. So listen, I think you were really one fight away from having that goal, because, you know, the $50,000 bonus, it does put your name a lot higher on everybody's mind. So you're obviously gonna be around for a long time. And Joe, I don't know if you actually listened to the fight after, but really, really complimentary of you, and couldn't say enough good things about you. So I hope you at least picked up on that.
I haven't watched fight yet, so I'm probably gonna go back and watch just listen to that.
Are you hard on yourself when you watch your own fights?
Oh yeah, very hard.
Talking to you. It was a great fight.